Chapter 21, Marathon Beyond the Polar Circle by Wim Hof. 2 weeks after Kilimanjaro, I was on my way to Lapland, Finland. After coordinating with an English production company, we came up with the idea to drive from Amsterdam to Lapland for a marathon. Along the way, we drove through Germany, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, and then finally landed in Lapland. Each country became colder as we traveled farther north. When we reached the southern part of Sweden, the snow began to fall. Slippery roads and very cold temperatures greeted us, yet we still had another 1,500 kilometers, 932 miles, to travel before reaching the polar circle. Eventually, we reached our final destination. It was a very small resort in Lapland. The place was made out of wood, but it kept us very warm. Outside, wild reindeer frolicked in the thick snow that surrounded us. It felt like a scene right out of a Christmas tale. When the temperature dropped down to negative 20 degrees Celsius, negative 4 degrees Fahrenheit, the condensed air froze, making the snow look like beautiful, sharp diamonds. Shortly after our arrival, we met a local fixer. A fixer, as most television personnel call it, is a person who arranges and plans out many different camera angles at the location of the shoot. While the fixer was attending to the angles, the rest of the crew needed to find a way to make a track for the marathon in the nearby hills. They had to figure out what exactly had to happen and where it would all take place, so it was good that they were very keen on the details. As I watched everyone working, I began to feel very anxious and alert. This is how I always feel before a challenge. It's a natural way to prepare the mind. The next day, we went to a reindeer farm and spoke with the herder. He was dressed in reindeer skin and lived in a typical Lapish nomad tent. It looked very similar to that of a teepee, very Indian-like. The Lapish nomads are also very similar to the North American Indians. The herder told us stories about their traditions, fire rituals, as well as their life and respect for nature and reindeer. The nomads in the area were diminishing quickly as snow scooters removed the necessity of transport by reindeer, leaving them with no income. I honestly feel that it is a pity to see modern times take over regions like this. One of the stories the herder told us explained how the Lapish people, also known as the Sami, had developed telepathy to speak to the faraway neighbors. However, once the telephones were invented, the telepathy disappeared with time. Another pitiful loss. The next day before the run, we went to the track and did some pickup shots. Pickup shots are the shots that you can't actually shoot when the run is live because the angle is too difficult. So, I took the opportunity to get a good workout in and ran for a bit through the snow, just in my shorts. The snow was neither hard nor soft. It was a different texture than what I had been used to, but I ran for a while through the white, covered wilderness. As I was running, the snow covered the ground in a way that made it hard to see what kind of surface I was stepping on. Everything seemed fine when all of a sudden I stepped on some uneven ground and heard a crick. My right ankle twisted and it began throbbing with pain. The next day was the day that I was supposed to run my first full marathon ever, and I just severely sprained my ankle. My confidence was shattered. Would I even be able to do this marathon? I thought. I was overwhelmed with insecurities and doubts, but the only thing that I could do was continue on with determination, mind over matter. I told the crew that we had to change the track on which I would be performing my run. I explained to them that I had sprained my ankle because the snow was too deep and it would be impossible to run through. They agreed to survey the surroundings and look at some different trails with hardened snow layers. I didn't sleep very well that night, but I was determined, and that gave me energy. The following morning before my run, I had to undergo a medical checkup. The professionals told me that my physiology was much healthier than an average young man. They told me that my resting heart rate was extremely low, a 38 beats per minute, with good blood pressure. Then, they saw my ankle. Their suggestion to me was that I should not run the marathon. Of course, I disagreed. They saw my determination and told me that if I chose to run it, it would be at my own risk. So after taping my ankle, the medical professionals wished me luck and sent me on my way. The newspaper and television reporters were present when I arrived at the starting point of the newly plotted course. I mentally prepared myself one last time before getting out of the car. When I was ready, I went outside, had a piss, and started running. I began my run so rapidly that it threw everyone off guard. No one had expected me to begin like that, so everyone had to quickly pack their bags and follow me up in a hurry to catch up. The crew all sat in the back of a car with the rear door propped open so that they could film me as I ran. They were driving a little bit ahead of me at a slow pace so that they can get some good shots. They filmed my feet from close up, far away, from the side, with wide angles and close angles. Everything was going extremely well. Kilometers passed and there were still no problems whatsoever, so I kept running. With everything going so well, my worrying had stopped and I was able to enjoy the environment. My regained confidence helped me relax and enjoy the nature that was in front of me. 10 kilometers went by, 20 kilometers, and I still had no problems. However, when I ran over the 25-kilometer mark, which is 15 miles, the cold began to have an influence on my muscles. The acid that had accumulated in my legs was really slowing me down. This is where the determined mind began to play its role. My mental preparation began to pay off as the run became a challenge of willpower. I pulled myself together and focused on every numbed step through the snow. I would not succumb to fatigue. Remaining focused can pull you through almost anything. It alerts the adrenaline and the nervous system to kick in. This run was a fight that I needed to win, just like Kilimanjaro. On Kilimanjaro, my fight was with the lack of air, but there in Lapland, it was the cold and my unprepared physical state. Months before this run, I had prepared myself by sitting in a horse stance with my knees bent over for a half hour to practice getting rid of acid buildup. It took focus, but it worked. This is the kind of focus I had to attain during my run. Despite the heavy feeling that I still had in my legs, I made it past the 32-kilometer mark, 19.8 miles. I stayed in my trance, traveling the long distance through the woods. By the time I reached the last 2 kilometers, I was almost walking. As my eyes fell upon the finish line, though, I regained some of my energy. The final stretch was adorned with cheering people and torches. My goal was now in reach. When I had crossed the finish line, I was engulfed in praise. I had done it. After my first full marathon was successfully completed, I was guided into a wooden hut where my family was waiting. They cheered for me when I entered. They sat me down by the fireside and handed me a beer and a cigarette. Like the Indians, I said, a cigarette smoke is for peace and accomplishment. Everyone around me was flabbergasted when they realized that I was a smoker and a drinker. Athletes don't typically have these habits. They were shocked at what I was able to achieve despite my vices. The reporters continued to ask me questions while the film crew reviewed their footage. The run was complete, and I was more than satisfied. I had just taken another pioneering step deeper into my mind. Once again, I was able to overcome my fears and insecurities. That night, when I was relaxing by the television, my run came on the news. It was a beautiful thing to see. The following day, my legs were incredibly sore. I could barely walk. The following 3-day car ride was enough time for my legs to completely recover. During the car ride home, I came up with a new challenge that I would like to someday fulfill: to run 50 kilometers, 31 miles, in the Sahara Desert without drinking any water. I hope to accomplish this goal sometime in the future.